received his actually his bachelor degrees from the University of Chile, a master degree and a PhD from Northwestern University. And then he became a professor of the physics at the University of California since 1987. And then professor received a lot of the prize, including the Lorentz Prize and the David Adler Lectureship, and so on. So a lot of prize, so in the rest, and also the homework of the award from the Germany in 2000. And he is also the fellow of the American Physics Society, and also the member of academia in many countries, for example, Belgium and Colombia, and also foreign member of the Chilean Academy of Science, and also the Spanish Academy of Science. Before I give the microphone to Professor Schurer, so you can see the pictures I found in his the website, I'd like to show another picture. So when I look at the picture, I found it very similar to another very famous superstar, which I really like. I don't know, you never find that. So you know the Jim Reno?
Yeah, no, of course I do, but
no one talks that this is a very, very similar. I think this is my the finding. You can use the program, you can have the PowerPoint file in the future.
You
never recognize it. Okay? So that's welcome to Professor Schurer. Not of course, not in the real.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I just would like to make sure that I give an appropriate talk. How many of you people are not solid-state physicists or condensed matter? Can you raise your hand? Okay, let me just get in. Just raise your hand. I'm not going to give you an exam, so I just want to know. If I should. Okay. Okay. So I was told that this is a colloquium, so I'm trying to give you a colloquium talk, not a technical talk. But you know, what happened was I got this award from the IEEE, which gave me the money to travel. Okay, so and because I got this distinguished lectureship, they actually forced me this title. So this is a very technical title. Yesterday, I gave this talk at Tsinghua University, which was mostly for magnetism people. So it was very technical. But then I suddenly realized that here I'm supposed to give a colloquium, so I changed my talk. So I'm not going to give the IEEE, but you know, since they paid, I have to tell you about the IEEE. There is nothing I can do about that. So you have to listen to this. This is what pays my travel. The IEEE has 360,000 members. It's one of the biggest professional societies in the world, and it does lots of different things. If you're a student and you want to become a member, I'm told that you get a discount. Okay, so it's cheaper. All right? And they publish all kind of things like the IEEE transaction on magnetics. So for those who are working magnetism, there is this IEEE magnetics letters. This is a famous, actually, magnetism guy, whose name is Bozort. He used to be at Bell Labs. He brought one of the best books in magnetism that there is, actually. And then, you know, it has very worldwide circulation. And you also get a discount there, you know. So it's like everything is discounted here. It's sort of like in the shilling market. Okay? Okay, so thank you for inviting me. Please feel free to ask questions. I know exactly how to give a talk. I lecture to many students in the US, and I can finish in an hour. So you don't have to worry that you have to sit here for 6 hours, okay? So you please ask me questions anytime, interrupt me. I know Taiwanese are very polite. You can hear me? Can you hear me there in the back or no? Can you hear me? Yes? Anybody that's a scuba diver, this means okay. So give me a sign if it's not okay. Go like this, and then I know that I'm not talking, okay? All right, good. So thank you for inviting me. It's a real pleasure for me to be here in Taiwan. So I had to give this talk actually a few weeks ago in Sweden, where this woman, Lise Meitner, who should have gotten the Nobel Prize and she did not get it, she's the woman who discovered fission, and here she says what we physicists think of ourselves. We think that the science makes people live selflessly for truth and objectivity. It teaches people to accept reality with wonder and admiration, not to mention the deep awe and joy that the natural order of things brings to the true scientist. This is what Lise Meitner thinks of physicists, and this is what we think of physicists. But let me disappoint you, because the rest of the world doesn't think that of us. So the rest of the world thinks of us that it is extremely boring. And the next thing that they think of us, that is the subject that is the best again, that never understood in high school or in college. And the next thing they say, you know, the more polite one, they say, the Taiwanese one say, you must be very intelligent. Actually, what they mean is you're very boring. Now, why do physicists get this impression? The reason is because when we give physics lectures, we always talk about springs and pulleys and inclined plates, electricity maybe, and you know, this is really boring. I mean, kind of, let's face it. Now, the more sophisticated people think that we actually work on bands, okay? On big bands and small bands, okay? Actually, this might have had something to do with the small band because fission led to the atom bomb. Actually, most of us don't work on that. I'm sorry to disappoint you, and that's why I was asking if there are any astronomers and high-energy physicists, because most of us don't work on that. Most of us don't do this, and that's what I will tell you about what most physicists do. Now, you see, the physics that we do is both fascinating and useful. It's not generally not useful because of me. I have not done anything useful in my life, so this is not the first time. But it is useful, the totality of the physics we do. And you use it millions of times a day, and while I'm giving this talk, I will let you think about it, and maybe I'll tell you how you, every one of you uses it millions of times a day, what I'm going to tell you. Okay, so I was sitting in Washington, this doesn't show very well, but this is the statue of Einstein that there is in Washington near the National Academy of Sciences. And I was sitting in his lab thinking about this, and said, then I went to Paris to think about this problem some more. No, don't turn it off, because people fall asleep. No sleeping in my classes. And so I was thinking about it, and so finally I came up with this title of this talk, which is Why Do Physics? And that's what I want to tell you about. Why do physics? And I'm not going to tell you about high energy physics. I'm not going to tell you about general relativity. I'm going to tell you about what I do. And you will see that it's really worth doing physics because of that. So my start started about 58 years ago in 1957 in physics. I was born in this country, Romania. This is my hometown, which had some names, you know. This is where Dracula is from. And in this corner, my wife insisted we go there to that corner. We went there, and I remember being 9 years old or something, and I remember thinking, my aunt was holding me by hand, and she asked me, so what do you want to do when you become big? And I said, I want to become a physicist. This was just after the Sputnik was sent up by the Russians. And I have no idea why I said that, but that's what and since then I wanted to be a physicist. And so that's the same corner from another angle, okay? So you don't see, So Lise Meitner, this famous woman, she said, life need not be easy, provided only that it's not empty. And that certainly is true for my life, because I was very lucky to live in Chile. And I'll show you, I'll connect it immediately with physics. Well, the one reason I was very lucky, because I met my wife there, okay? And she actually, that's Jackie the teacher. And then this is one of my older sons, who's an oceanographer. So that's Danny the oceanographer. And that's my physicist son, that's Johnny the physicist, okay? So all these three came from because of Chile, because I was in Chile. But there is another reason that I was lucky to live in Chile. So there was another reason why I was quite lucky, is because I studied in Chile. So this Chile actually is in very recently. Does anybody have a green laser pointer?
Yes, it's gone. Please.
It's here? Oh, okay. I have some batteries if I... Okay, this is good. No, this is good. That's fine. No, this is fine. Okay, so I was lucky to study Chile. This is Chile, okay? This is a very beautiful country. You know, and this is in the south of Chile, in the Patagonia. Because, you know, we not only that we had this beautiful country, but we had, you know, these are all a physics meeting. And so this is what we did in physics meetings in Chile. But we could ask fundamental questions. And that's what I want to tell you about. It's the fundamental questions that in small countries, and Taiwan is kind of like Chile. It's a small country, has very few number of inhabitants, but you can still, as a physicist, and ask fundamental questions. You don't have to make something extremely useful like we have to do it in the US. And so, what was the fundamental question that I first learned in Chile? I learned that how you can get something from nothing. Now, here it is how you can get something from nothing. There's a famous thing called the Noether's theorem. This was another very famous, one of the most famous mathematicians, women, Amy Noether, who got conservation laws out of philosophy. And I'll show you this in a second. And there was the Ginzburg-Landau second order phase transition, where you can get all superconductivity magnetism from a Taylor expansion. Okay? Get something from nothing. Now, how is it? Amy Noether came up with, so this Amy Noether is the best photograph I could find of her, but the symmetry and conservation laws. And she came up with this idea that because space is uniform, because of that, she wrote down equations of conservation of angular momentum. It's getting something from nothing. You know, you think, well, space is uniform, who the hell cares? Actually, you can get conservation laws, real numbers and real, and this governs all physics. You can get linear momentum conservation, energy conservation, all this from symmetries of space. Landau and Ginzburg, they took and they Taylor expanded their free energy in series, and they showed that by a Taylor expansion of free energy, you can get pretty much all superconductivity and magnetism, pretty much all of it that's important, okay? The rest of it is just philosophy, you know? You can get that out of, so you get something from nothing. And so when I saw this, I remember especially when I was an undergraduate, I was in second year as an undergraduate of physics, I saw Noether's theorem, I said, this is fantastic, it's absolutely extraordinary. Or when I saw Ginzburg-Landau theory. And so here it is, I went to the US and I decided I have to work on something. So this is me. So that's how I look like, you know, like, I don't know, like Alain Delon. All right? So here it is that my thesis work is called Photoexcitation Superconductors, 1976. And here it is the measurement that I did. I decided I'm going to work on the Ginzburg-Landau theory. Now this is a lesson for the young people, is that I am still extremely proud of my thesis work. I think this is one of my best works. I published on the order of 500 papers or 600, I don't even know how many. But a lot of papers, believe me. I'm still, this is one of my best. And this was the following thing, is a measurement of the relaxation time of a superconductor, the energy gap. You deviate it a little bit and ask yourself, how does it relax back to equilibrium? That's this measurement. So there it is, the superconducting transition temperature. You measure the relaxation time as a function of temperature. And this is just one more step, Ginzburg-Landau theory, but time-dependent Ginzburg-Landau theory. And what the relaxation time does, it diverges at close to the transition temperature. As you're coming closer and closer to the transition temperature, as you deviate the superconductor from equilibrium, it relaxes slower and slower and slower. This is the first direct measurements of this quantity in any second-order phase transition system, and it's what and what is now called in the literature critical slowing down. I'm very proud of this. This is still valid and this is still correct. Okay, this is now, it's called pump probe experiments. If you've heard of pump probe, this was pump probe way before it was called pump probe. Okay, so here it is my group. So, you know, that's the second thing that that physics allowed me to have is many young friends. I mean, here it is part of my group that we met at the March meeting. And I will tell you about the work of some of these guys. So these are all these people. If you're not in this picture, you should be, because we probably could work with this. That's me, okay, there's all kind of people there. So here it is what my students actually thought of me. A member of my crew must be tough, ruthless, and never give up, even when things look completely hopeless. And this is what makes you qualify, I go to Diamond Sugar. Okay, so that's what my students think of me. Okay, so here it is what they came up with. Why do physics? And I came up with four reasons why you want to do physics. Especially the type of physics that I will tell you about. Universal behavior, power laws. So I will show you this in a second. So here it is, a material which is not a simple element. It's made out of two elements, vanadium oxide, VO2. Now this is current research, so I'm not telling you about something that is 35 years old. I'm telling you something that is from last year. And this is the electrical resistance of this material, VO2, as a function of temperature. And this material does something absolutely fantastic, which people don't understand how does it do that. It goes from being metallic resistance, very low resistance, notice this is a logarithmic scale, and then it changes 5 orders of magnitude and becomes very high resistance. So it goes from being at high temperature a low resistance, a metal, to being a high resistance, an insulator. Okay, there is what is called a metal insulator transition. So only two elements, when Eddie Bonds said, actually is not well understood why does it do this. Okay? So here it is a measurement that we decided to just do it this at the nanoscale, measure it at very short distances. So here look, you see, here it is some electrodes, some electrical electrodes. So those bright things are electrical resistors. And all we measure is the resistance between these two points. Now notice here that the gaps here between these two electrodes is different here, different there, so we can make it in different sizes, just to check that we are not making some mistake. And you measure the electrical resistance, there it is again, this is my lab, 200 nanometer vanadium oxide VO2 layer, there it is the resistance, the electrical resistance. Notice first of all, this electrical resistance is hysteretic. So when you go down in temperature, it comes back at a different curve. It's like water and ice. It's first order phase transition. Number one. Sorry, I have this cough that I can get rid of. Oh, okay, thank you. And so that's the first thing that you have to notice here. Now the second thing that you notice, there is some errors there. There is like something very strange. This is not a smooth curve, like you would see in most phase transition. And you know, if you have a good eye, then you start wondering, why is there that? I mean, I know how to measure a resistance. That's one thing I do know how to do very well. And you expand that scale, so that scale is now expanded a lot. It's expanded along this direction. There's discontinuities in this. The resistance doesn't change continuously. It jumps suddenly. And then, if you go back and forth, it jumps at different places. So you think, okay, so this guy doesn't know how to measure resistance. And this is extremely boring. I mean, why do you want to do anything with this? Well, so let's say you expand that section of the curve. You expand it, it looks like this, like I showed you. Then you expand this part of the curve, there's always a big transition and lots of small transitions. It looks again, big transition, lots of small transitions. You expand it there, you have big transitions, lots of small transitions. It is self-similar. Okay, the curve is self-similar from and so now you can do something with this, because what you can do is you can plot the number of jumps as a function of jump size. So you ask yourself, how many jumps of 500, how many jumps of, I don't know, 40 ohms there are 500 of them. How many jumps of you know, 1 ohm there is 90 of them or whatever. Okay? And actually, if you look, take this plot and you plot it in a log-log scale, then it becomes a straight line. See, so that's the log of the number of the same curve as this one versus the log of jump size. And what that immediately means, something very profound. That means that there is a power law, that the probability of having a jump of a certain size goes as the jump size to the minus alpha, some power minus alpha. Okay? It turns out that all the physics is actually not alpha. The rest of it tells you that the system is self-similar. Okay? Here it is another example, and that immediately relates to avalanches. So I don't know, probably in Taiwan there is no skiing, right? Are there any skiers here in the audience? Well, so if you go skiing, if you ever wondered about, here it is a guy who goes skiing, and here it is what happens if you go down the mountain with a snowboard. Okay, yeah. So there it is, this guy, somewhere, I think it's in Spain, he's going down a big mountain there, and notice what happens is that as he goes down, there is kind of little amount of snow that is pushed around, and then there is a lot of snow being pushed around, and again, you will see there is a little bit of snow pushed around, and a lot of snow pushed around. So it's always a little small jumps, and then as he goes suddenly around, he's going to start again in just one moment. Then notice there, so suddenly there is a huge jump, okay? So the resistance, so that is what is called an avalanche. Okay, so the way the resistance changes, it jumps a little bit more, and then suddenly launches a big avalanche. That's what those different steps are. Okay? So this is very universal. This happens in snow skiing. It happens, so it's always, you know, it triggers and it develops many small avalanches and a few big ones. What the hell is with my finger or something? I'm doing wrong to the laser point. I kill all the laser points. Okay. But there is universality to this. This doesn't only happen in vanadium oxide. No, think about it. Physics is something very universal. It happens in vanadium oxide, which has nothing to do with H2O and skin in the. But it happens in many other circumstances. Here it is. The earth, the magnitude of earthquakes, so in Chile there's lots of earthquakes. And if you look at the magnitude of the earthquakes, as the magnitude of the earthquake is the number of earthquakes, it has a power log and the log of that. And the power is 1.2. Okay? If you look at the nodes within the internet, as a function of node connectivity, it's a power law. Okay? It's a power law with a power of 2.1. All the physics is in that exponent. The rest of it is exactly the same. That's how physics is very fascinating. Even if you're an engineer, even if you're a high energy physicist, you should find this interesting. You should even find it more interesting that if you look at the number of papers as a function of number of citations of Ivan Schuller, it's a power law of 1.7. So I am contained in this number. I am 1.7. I don't know, I have no idea. I don't know what that means. Actually, I have no idea what that means. And you find this everywhere. You find it in Barkhausen noise, which is a magnetism thing. You find it in Martensitic phase transitions. You find it in sun pipes. You find it in the plasma or the corona of the sun. Everywhere there is this power laws. And everywhere, the whole physics is contained in this number. Physics is very universal. That's what's interesting about it. So that's the very first thing that I wanted to tell you. But that's not the physics. Okay. Now the second thing is new parameter ranges. So it turns out that we physicists, the way chemists look at the world is like this. They say there's a nucleus there and there's some electrons going around. That's a molecule or an atom or whatever the hell that is. And then they say, well, okay, let's make it bigger, make molecules and more collections of molecules. We physicists look at it differently. We just, like I look at this laser, we have a laser there in a battery. And we make it smaller. And somewhere in the intermediate range here, there is some characteristic length scale, okay, which is what is called nanoscience. That's where the words were, you know, kind of 20 years ago started, and there is this nanoscience thing. Actually, and so there is the reason that is interesting is not because it's called nanoscience. The reason it's interesting is because there is a lot of surprises that we find there. And let me show you first the first surprise. So everybody has in the lab something called a nanovoltmeter. Every experimentalist knows what that is. I wanted to show you who's the first person that came up with this idea of nanoscience. This was a French theorist by the name of François-Marie Arouet. Does anybody know who François-Marie Arouet is? Okay, no one. Even in France, I couldn't find anybody. This is what he said. There is a book. This is the first book on nanoscience. I found it. It was last year. I had to go to Paris to spend a sabbatical to find this book. It is a nano book. It's a book called Micro Omegas. Later on, I'll tell you, you'll find it. It's a very interesting science fiction book. And what he does is he compares the size of an animal on the Earth with the size of the Earth itself. And then he says, how big would that animal be if it would be on a ball of a size of 1 meter? That's what he says here. And it turns out that that would be of the order of 10 nanometers. So this is the first thing of what is called the nanobio. Okay, there's lots of people that work on this nanobio. But this was already invented by François-Marie Arouet. I'm telling you that book called Micromegas. And that guy is this gentleman whose name is Voltaire. Now, you may have heard of Voltaire, who's a famous French philosopher of the 17th century, who's actually buried. I lived a block away from where he's buried, okay, in the Pantheon. Okay, so when I started working on these small things, this was in 1980, I published a physical letter. And I started wondering, what happens if you layer two metals, an orange metal and a blue metal, copper and iron, for instance, or copper and manganese, or something. You make layers of it. These are now called superlattices. This eventually gave rise to this type of material, giant magnetoresistance was discovered, GMR, by these two gentlemen, Fert and Grünberg. You can see that Fert is very happy about this. Grünberg, for some reason, is not that happy, but they got the Nobel Prize anyway. But if you look at the Nobel archives and you look at the justification of the Nobel Prize, they talk about the discovery of giant magnetoresistance. And this is what they say there. They say in this connection, it should be mentioned that in several publications, prior to the work of Feld and Grunberg, there were reports of observation of substantial magnetoresistance effect. Reference 9, 10, 11, and 12. There is reference 9. I. Schuller, okay? I'm the first author, mind you. I was the guy who did the experiments. No, I was not a professor. I did it with my own hands. Okay, that's why I'm the first author on that paper, 1979. The other guys followed me in 1987, much later, 88. So at least the Nobel Committee, you know, so this is what I got. Feld and Grunberg became famous, and I got this mention here that I have to point out always to people that I mentioned there. But hey, that's, it could be worse. It could be that nobody mentions me. Okay? So this will give rise to all these things that now you see. You know? So typically in this kind of a talk that I'm giving today, people talk about applications, how useful this thing is. You know, there's sensors, there's MRAMs, there's hard disk drives, all kinds of stuff. Well, I don't care, actually, because what I care about is about studying this simple system, an antiferromagnetic layer coupled to a ferromagnetic layer, some inert material and some other ferromagnetic layer. This four-layer system gives rise to all these applications. But I don't care about the applications, actually. All I care is about the science. And so that's what I want to tell you about, is science, not applications. So don't, I'll tell you maybe some applications later if you really push me, but I don't really care. So there's GMR, you know, which was discovered in this trilayer system, which is what I was telling you, that Feld and Grunberg got the Nobel Prize. Then today now, if you put a current through something that people didn't realize, if you put a current through a magnetic material, you can flip the spin, which is called the spin torque effect, which is actually presumably is going to go into application soon. There is also another thing that I spent quite a bit of my life, maybe 10 or 15 years of my life worrying about, is about this interface between the antiferromagnet and the ferromagnet. That is what is called exchange bias, and I spent quite a bit of time of my life on that. Okay? So this is all basic research kind of a thing that comes from studying things at the nanoscale, at the small scale. Okay, so again, let me just remind you. This is a Woodstock, you know, from Peanuts, and he's asking him, well, you know, what is all this thing that's falling down? He says, that's the rain. It helps things to grow. It fills up the lakes and oceans so the fish can swim around and gives us all something to drink. And Woodstock doesn't care what it is as long as he understands it. That's me. That's actually the first page of my thesis. So my thesis, I kept this cartoon for 10 years because I thought this is what I want to do with my life. Okay? So what I want to point out to you, that basic research leads to these transformative technologies. That is not the other way around. It's not by trying to improve something 20% is what will give you something fantastic. It's trying to come up with very brilliant ideas or bright ideas what gives rise to these fantastic discoveries. Then, of course, you have to improve things 10% and 20%, push it here, push it there. But the big revolution comes from this basic research. Okay, now where this comes and how it comes is very difficult to predict. That's the hard part. Okay, so now let me tell you about strange, weird behavior. This is something that is very strange because if I tell you the following, is that if I take a ball and I spin it, I can make an experiment in which the ball is going to move that way, and the spinning of the ball is going to move that way. Now you say, this is a completely crazy idea. How can you separate the spinning of the ball? I will show you an experiment. I can do it in my lab. And many people have done it in the lab. This is what is called the Cheshire Cat. I don't know if you guys probably hear. There's a famous English book written by an English writer called Alice in Wonderland. And in Alice in Wonderland, there's a cat that smiles. And what this cat does is very strange cat, because what he does is he moves away, but he leaves a smile behind. Okay, so the cat moves away, but the smile stays behind. And that's what I will show you. This is what is conceptually what it is. So here is the device that I can make a completely crazy experiment. I take a normal material like gold, copper, aluminum, doesn't matter what it is, and I put two ferromagnetic layers on top of it. And then what I do is I put a current in this direction here, in this loop. And then I will measure the voltage there. Now, what should be the voltage there? The current flows in this circuit. What should be the voltage between those two points there? Zero, right? I mean, that is, I teach that every year, I teach it in electricity and magnetism. If the current flows this way,